Well, I hope I'm not going to disappoint you, because I haven't really got any answers, easy answers about how we can develop more positive attitudes towards language learning. But I hope that my exploration of this issue of grit is something that we can learn from anyway, even though, as you will discover, I'm not going to suggest for a second that grit is going to provide much in the way of solutions. But it is a very interesting case study. Grit. If you haven't come across the topic before, let's get that. The term's been around for a little while. I mean, even way, way back to an old John Wayne movie called True Grit, meaning true courage, I guess, in this case, but also courage, which continues for a long time. Grit came onto the educational agenda 6 years ago in 2016 with the publication of this book by Angela Duckworth called Grit. And I'll give you a second just to read the description of grit as she defines it herself. Well, now the definition here is a little bit vague. It talks about combining resilience, ambition, and self-control. But you'd have to read the whole book to get a deeper understanding of what she actually means. And my suspicion is that even when you've read the whole book, you may not be completely clear about what grit is. To what extent is it resilience, and to what extent is it different from resilience? How much ambition is needed, and how much self-control? So there is a problem which I'll come back to in terms of defining grit. However, Angela Duckworth's basic message clearly resonated with a very, very large number of people. This book very quickly became an international bestseller. And even though, in a sense, its basic message is just the positive message of yes, you can, she managed to sort of capture something in the zeitgeist. This success of the book was mirrored by the success of her talk on TED. Now, it's impossible to really be clear about how many millions of views it's had, but it certainly had more than 10 million views on the TED channel itself, on YouTube, and in various other sources. This is a huge success in terms of impact. Grit has also inspired a large number of people in the educational world, both teachers, school leaders, and educational authorities at the sort of local or regional or ministerial level. And they have pumped in millions and millions of dollars or pounds or euros or whatever currency it may be to promote this idea that in order for our learners to be successful learners, they need to be gritty. In the UK alone, over 5 million was spent in the very early days pumped into programs that were promoting grit in schools. So the impact has been absolutely huge. And all the way down the line, I suppose, there has been this assumption that no one's going to disagree that grit is important. Clearly, our learners need to be gritty. And learning a language is a long-term job. You're not going to learn it overnight. Anyone who claims you can learn a language in 20 hours or 50 hours is simply talking nonsense. You need a long period of time to learn a language, and therefore grit is going to be key to your success or not. So there's a general acceptance that grit is important, but the question that follows is, well, then how do we actually promote it? What do we do? How do we make our non-gritty students gritty? And the claims are made on a regular basis that grit can be taught, it can be learned, it can be developed, but I'm going to challenge these in a few minutes. When you look at the practical suggestions of how grit can be learned or developed, there is an incredible crossover between these suggestions and the suggestions that are made to promote growth mindset. After all, growth mindset, the belief that you can do something, is really very closely related to grit. So the sorts of things which are talked about as practical interventions are the following. Often there's some kind of teaching learners about brain plasticity, learning that the brain is not fixed in terms of the way that new connections can be forged and made and strengthened and so on, that the brain is a plastic organ. I've never really thought this tells us very much. Saying that the brain is plastic is really just another way of saying that the brain can learn things, because of course any learning involves changes in brain organization. But anyway, teaching learners about brain plasticity seems to have been quite an important part of it. There's also a significant element of showing learners examples of people who have achieved success despite adversity. This may be stories of, I don't know, let's say somebody who's grown up in a very underprivileged background and has seen massive success in one aspect of their lives. A third aspect of this promotion of grit and growth mindset is giving positive feedback to learners. And I've seen this quite often in the classroom with teachers telling their students, yes, no, mistakes are good. You can learn from mistakes. Let's be positive about it. Let's not get too downhearted. On one of the recent occasions when I saw this taking place with a teacher telling her learners this, it was a primary school here in Vienna where I live. And the teacher was saying, oh, kids, listen, mistakes are good. You can learn from them. And I could see three or four of the children just rolling their eyes. And one of the kids put her hand up and she said, oh, please, miss. No, mistakes are not good. We have to correct them. Because, of course, that's the main message that they've learned from school. So the idea is we need to be more positive. Part of the positivity might come from inspirational posters and quotes. You often see classrooms with, you know, yes, you can style posters on the walls. Again, I'm not totally convinced that these will make much difference, but why not? They're not going to do any damage. And increasingly now, there are a number of apps, grit apps. These are a bit like Fitbits for life or Fitbits for your study, where you set yourself goals and you have to meet these goals. And then there are reminders about how you need to do this and you need to do that. So apps now have become big business. Grit itself has become quite a significant commercial world. And one final thing, which I should mention in terms of promoting grit and growth mindset, is that learners are often encouraged to watch the Angela Duckworth video that I mentioned just a few seconds ago. It's quite interesting. If you go onto YouTube and you watch the video, I recommend it's an interesting video. But if you've got the time, scroll down through the comments. And if you get to the comments, which were posted around a few months into the COVID pandemic, you'll see somebody writes the comment, a quarantine got me assigned to this vid. They've been told when they were doing homeschooling that they had to watch this video about grit. And you can understand why, because during the pandemic when homeschooling was everywhere, grit was clearly necessary for learners to maintain their motivation over the period of homeschooling. But what's really funny about this this comment on YouTube, that this was assigned viewing during the lockdown, was that the comments that follow this quarantine got me assigned to this vid is the next person making comments is me too, me too, me too, me too. And there's a whole pile of these kids who've been told to watch this video during their homeschooling. So these are the kinds of things that are usually suggested in terms of promoting grit and growth mindset, because there seems to be this huge crossover. And then the question that we have to ask is, well, do any of these things actually make a difference? They're not going to do any damage. Well, I don't think so. But I gave the example of giving positive feedback to learners. A lot of learners simply don't even hear this. They don't believe the sort of stuff that the teacher may say. So there is this question, does any of this make a difference? And there has been a certain amount of research. The two biggest bits of research I've put on the screen here. The first one at the top is a meta-analysis, so looking at lots and lots of different pieces of research and bringing them together. And the second is a piece of journalism which summarizes this. The problem, unfortunately, in answering the question is, does it work? Well, unfortunately, we don't have any evidence that it does work. At least what evidence there is doesn't suggest unequivocally that it will work. There are a number of problems in determining whether it works or not, how the research is carried out, over what period of time, and so on. But there is, at the moment, and this is 2017, but even 5 years later, there is still no empirical support to the claim that grit can be learned, taught, and developed. And this, of course, is a rather big problem. Even in the literature which is specific to language learning, a paper 2 years ago concluded that substantial amounts of further research will be needed before anything can be recommended as a way of promoting grit. The basic answer then is we've really no idea whether any of these interventions work or not. Again, they're unlikely to do any harm, but will they work? Who knows? Maybe we'll be better off spending our time with some other activity. And interestingly, Angela Duckworth herself, I mean, remember, she's the person that came up with this term grit and its value in education. Duckworth herself is not even convinced herself. In one interview a few years ago, she said that she hopes it's something that people can learn, but she also admitted that we didn't have enough proof to confirm that they can actually learn it. So big, big question marks that we need to ask, and anyone who's claiming that grit can be taught, learned, developed, needs to be treated with a degree of skepticism. There are some problems with grit. I suggested at the beginning that Angela Duckworth's construct of grit was rather problematic. It was never really adequately defined. It's a combination of resilience and ambition and self-regulation, and it's a combination of those things with resilience and conscientiousness and much more beside, practice and hope. All of these things come into the picture. So the question is grit a useful construct? After all, we've been studying resilience and consciousness for quite a long time. And the general conclusion is that although grit may be something which we seem to understand intuitively, there is no particularly compelling reason to even accept that grit is a thing. It's a combination of different things, but it may not actually be terribly useful as a construct. If we can't define it, then clearly we can't measure it. And there is a danger here, because if we assume that we can measure something which hasn't been defined, we are attempting to measure what is fundamentally the unmeasurable. And there is a follow-on danger from this, which Angela Duckworth herself has acknowledged. And she says, "These days I worry that I've contributed to an idea I vigorously oppose, that is high stakes character assessment. We shouldn't be measuring this. It's unethical." Two further problems with grit. First, in terms of the definition, it's a combination of passion and perseverance. I suppose we could think, yeah, we might be able to do something about perseverance, but can we actually teach passion? But if we had any idea how to teach passion, you know, you could become a major teaching educational star globally. We have no idea how to teach passion, and it's possibly the case that passion cannot be taught. And the last big question is, how fair is grit? Grit interventions are often used in schools where students are underperforming. But when students are underperforming, there are often very complex reasons. They may well be coming from socially disadvantaged backgrounds. They may well be the victims of all sorts of problems in their home environment. So to suggest to someone who is suffering because of social reasons that if they just have enough grit, they can sort it all out is basically simply unfair. And we do know that most grit interventions have been targeted at those children who are already disadvantaged. Has it helped them? Probably not, but we don't really know. So there are big problems with grit, which encourage us to be skeptical. But I'd like to just conclude with thinking, well, what can we actually learn from this? I am quite unambiguously saying, forget about grit. We can talk about resilience. We can talk about consciousness. We might even be able to talk about growth mindset. But grit is not a useful construct. What can we learn? I think there are three things, or three useful reminders. First of all, motivation is absolutely crucial in any effective learning, and that means that a positive learning environment is going to be necessary. I don't think that you get a positive learning environment by telling students not to worry about making mistakes. I think you get that environment by showing them through your actions that mistakes don't matter. I think we can learn from grit, which is a lot about goal setting, that students need to be set clear goals, and these goals have to be achievable. And I'll talk about this a little bit more in a few minutes when I come on to coaching. Goal setting is massively important. And finally, because language learning is a long-term project, it's going to take quite a while. Learners must develop some degree of autonomy, of learner autonomy, and they must develop some degree of self-confidence to have the self-belief that they can get where they need to get. And there is already a mass of stuff out there in the teaching journals, websites, books, etc., on how to build self-confidence in our learners. Grit is simply not needed. That's what I have to say then. I've not been as positive as I'd like to be on this topic, but that's my conclusion. Thanks very much, and I'll be back in a few minutes. Thank you.